Petros, you got bumped yesterday, AM 570 LA Sports, wildly successful Petros and Money Show, for the President of the United States. How did that make you feel?
It kind of shrunk the world for me a little too much, to be honest, if you know what I mean.
Yes.
The leader of the free world, and then me, is a bit of a, I don't know, wacky comparison. But
yes.
I am that person with the Taylor Swift music, and good morning to you, and congratulations on your interview with the president.
What'd you think of it?
I thought it was, I mean, I remember a long time ago when I first started the show with Matt, Rudy Giuliani came on.
Yep.
When he was campaigning for president, and it was similar. I was very complimentary of the show, knows how to be interviewed, knows how to guide an interview where he wants it to go, and I listened to the whole thing. It wasn't very different from what we hear most of the time from the guy because he's so available.
Yeah.
And does so much talking, which is really, really amazing. But I did listen to it and got a bunch of Twitter followers just off being bumped. Amazing.
Here is something else I think is interesting, and I can't get past this. Trump himself called Danny G, right?
Yeah,
I think that's wild to me because you know this. So many athletes or coaches or, you know, people who are in positions of prominence have someone else call.
Please hold for Keenan Allen. Please hold for Julian
Edelman. Like you're saying, like Keenan Allen, who is, I mean, a talented player, but it's not like most people would have any clue who Keenan Allen is. He has an apparatus in place in order for you to talk to him. Like somebody else calls on his behalf. Danny G, I think you can like the president just said, hey, like you picked up the phone and it was Donald Trump.
Yeah, and it shocked me. I was frozen at first because I expected his press secretary or somebody from the White House. And instead, it was Donald saying, I'd like to talk to Clay, please.
I mean, that to me is just amazing.
That is, it's interesting. I mean, it's on such a, like saying, it shrinks the world. I mean, it's on such a different level. But I remember when I was a USC football player, our head coach was second time around. He had won a national championship there in the 70s or 80s, John Robinson. And he now works with Coach Ogeron down at LSU as a giant middle finger to USC. And he was a really gregarious, very, very talkative, really, really good communicator. And he did all his own media. I remember, like, he would call Fox Sports and say, okay, I'm ready. You know, he didn't have his SID do that kind of stuff. But when it goes all the way up to the presidency, it's pretty shocking, especially since, like, I text with Danny G during the day and stuff, and I know what that studio looks like. And usually when the phone rings, it's, you know, Steve DeSager with an update on the Major League Baseball scores or, you know, who won an extra inning. So it was a very different day for Fox Sports Radio, no doubt about it. And it's history.
Yeah, I mean, and like I said to Danny G, the thing I was most nervous about was our phone system working, was our technology holding up.
I was thinking of that. And I don't, you know, I only joined your show on the phone. Like, I wonder, you know, I hope their phone doesn't blow up or something.
Yeah, you and me both. All right, speaking of blowing up, you mentioned that you played football at USC. You are very familiar with the Big 12, with the Big 10, with all of college football. But the decision by the Big 10 and the Pac-12 to cancel, did it surprise you? Is it the right decision?
Well, it happened pretty fast. And I am not a person that can say whether it's right or wrong. My inkling is that if you can play pro football and the money that circulates through the Power Five, you can play college football with a very similar protocol.
Yep.
If you just admit to yourself what it really is, which is a business. Now, the players don't get paid, and that's a huge problem, and that's always been a problem. But the problem with the players not getting paid is something that was set up in the 70s called Title IX. So something progressive that happened almost like 40 years ago or more than 40 years ago is keeping something from progressive happening now.
Yeah, it's fascinating, and it's well said. A lot of people don't understand that, but Title IX requires that women basically receive the same treatment in college athletics as men. And so if you are going to pay football players or men's basketball players, theoretically under federal law, you would have to pay women as well. And the entire athletic department structure collapses if every athlete has to be paid.
Right, and you really can only pay the revenue sports.
That's
right. There's got to be a way to pay those guys while they're at your institution of higher education as well, which is not easy. So these conversations get a lot bigger. And really what it's about is just defining college football for what it is, a billion-dollar industry wrapped inside our institutions of higher education. If they want to continue, especially this year, they're going to have to get out from under the umbrella of the NCAA because it's obviously just too complicated for them to figure out regionally. I mean, the interesting thing about the conferences is, I mean, the other than being in the Pac-12, what does Arizona State and Stanford or Utah and Cal have in common? I mean,
right. Nothing.
And that's why you see all this different splintering. I believe that somebody this year is going to play college football. And if they pull it off, like the NFL looks like they're going to be able to pull it off, at least right now, then it's going to make the Pac-12 look more toothless than ever. And we're very toothless. I mean, canceling football is one thing in the Pac-12, but just sitting here and waiting for the Big Ten to say it's okay,
yeah,
like a huge cock. It's like, make your own freaking decision, for God's sakes. And then for the power of the Pac-12, USC, to just not even act like they want to play, like the Ohio States and the Michigans and the Nebraskas of the world, for USC just to take it lying down just goes to show how far we've fallen on the West Coast. I'm not saying that it's the absolute wrong thing to cancel. People are running whatever doctor they want out there to confuse everybody, and it's a very confusing time, and they are players that are not paid. But what else are they going to do? I mean, these players are primed and ready to play. This is what they do. We are belittling and robbing them of their identity. I mean, think about this, all these incongruities, Clay. The best player on Purdue's football team is a guy named Rondale Jones. You heard of him?
Rondale Moore, I think, right?
Moore, excuse me. Yeah, Rondale Moore. Rondale Jones is a different guy.
Yeah.
Rondale Moore is a great receiver. He could have gone a lot of different places. He ended up going to a smaller school to be a big fish, or he really liked Brom and the recruitment out of the Louisville thing. Whatever reason, he's at Purdue. Purdue's inviting the biggest freshman class in the history of the school or something this fall.
Yes.
They're moving into the dorms right now.
That's right.
Rondale doesn't get to play right now because his team canceled. He could have gone to an Ohio State or an SEC school. At least Ohio State's acting like they're giving it a try. And if you can't protect Rondale from playing football, how the hell are you supposed to protect the biggest freshman class coming in the
history
of Purdue?
That's my question. That's my question that I've been hammering on the Big Ten in particular.
That's a pile of BS.
Yeah, right. It just doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't. And that's another problem. Like, the universities, if they want to cancel and say we're doing this to protect the players, hey, I don't blame them. Suddenly, they care about the players' well-being. If you cared about protecting players, you probably would just get rid of football. But let's put that aside. Let's say the universities really do care about protecting players, and they're finally taking a stand, and they're willing to take the financial hit, obviously, in the Pac-10 and the Big Ten right now. That's more noble than I thought they were, but then where's the nobility when you're charged, if you're USC and you're still charging something like $60,000 a year to go to school online?
Yeah.
I mean, that's not a college experience. I mean, these places maybe stop building like a giant tower of Babel to the sky this year and do what the rest of us, or many of us, have had to do. Dig into your savings, try not to fire everybody, and batten down the hatches for a year, if that's really who you are. But there's so much contradiction that it really is just a product of our sport, right, Clay? I mean, we love college football because it's really, really scattered and there's a lot of arguments, and it's regional and it's tribal. But that's also going to be a huge stumbling block to getting everybody on the same page.
All we do is argue about college football. And that's one of the things that makes it fun, but it's also, in a situation like this, one of the things that makes it start to collapse. But I just go to the essence of what you said. Big Ten schools in particular, because I think a lot of Pac-12 schools are not welcoming students back to campus. But if you are going, like you just said, Purdue is welcoming the largest freshman class in the history of the state, in theory. If you're going to welcome all of these kids across all these different Big Ten campuses back to school, you can't then tell me that it's not safe for the athletes who are going to be going to school there to play because of the coronavirus. If it's not safe for them to play because of the coronavirus, how is it safe for you to have everybody back on campus? And here's the other thing, Petros, I think the Big Ten schools are saying, we're not playing, but we're still going to train for 20 hours a week, theoretically, for football. Like, you played football. Is there anything less fun than being in the entire semester continuing to do 20 hours of football work when you're not going to get to play?
Yeah, I mean, you're going to probably lose a team that way or risk it potentially. I mean, none of us have ever dealt with anything like this before. But I don't think people really understand that these players do not need media members, people in social media, and university administrators that relate with them, not at all, really, because the players on campus are so much different than everybody else that's there. They suddenly don't need these people looking out for their well-being. I mean, they never did before. And the risks of playing college football have always been gigantic, multifold risks. But when it comes to the virus, I mean, I'm no medical expert, and I'm not one of the doctors that any of these conferences have run out to say it's okay or not okay to play. But it seems to me that a bunch of students at a bar or hanging out on campus or doing whatever college students do as freshmen in a dorm is a lot more problematic than 85 elite scholarship athletes trying to put it together. But this thing is filled with contradiction, and it's hard. I mean, Ohio State right now doesn't really have football, and they're the premier program in the world, or one of them, one of the top three, and they're playing high school football in Ohio right now, or getting ready to. Utah's playing high school football this week, but the Utah Utes, who have a bunch of guys who are trying to develop and play in the NFL, they're not going to play. You know, that's a huge issue. And the other, I mean, if there is one thing I would blow a whistle on health-wise, it's playing two seasons in 2021.
Yeah, which is what, for people out there who are like, oh, well, they'll be fine, they'll play in the spring, I've been saying for a long time, spring football is not really a viable possibility. But as somebody who played at USC, you think that's crazy?
Well, it's a bludgeoning. I mean, it's going to affect – I mean, one guy doing this or that, or a guy playing in the World League or the XFL or whatever and then turning it around and going to an NFL camp. I mean, individual stories of these kind of feats are not uncommon. But when you do it on a macro level, it will devastate the sport. And if you really want to put people's bodies at risk, I mean, we're not talking about playing an extra tennis or golf season or basketball even, where the guys play in the Olympics in the summer and it wears them down. I mean, we're talking about a sport where people literally bludgeon each other. And it has to be mitigated throughout the year with your body in a certain kind of way. Throwing that chemistry off, which we already have done at the highest level and in college, is going to have an effect. But I think playing two seasons, 2021, you know, nine games in the spring and then turning it around and trying to do what we normally do in the fall, my guess would be that would be have untold detrimental effects on a lot of players' bodies and would be a huge story and devastating if we tried.
You told us last week, and I thought it was well said, that your average college football player believes he is, like, indestructible, right?
Sure.
That is what you have to believe. And also, look, let's be honest, your average 18, 19, 20-year-old person in general believes that. It's just that college football players believe it even more, almost on steroids, right? Whatever the average 18 or 19 or 20-year-old
Well, think of who you are.
Yes.
I mean, you're probably the prom king. I mean, you're the biggest star.
You're the biggest, baddest guy from your high school.
Yeah, everybody is watching you. Yep. If you get on the kickoff team, everybody in your hometown, you know, watches you run down on the kickoff like you just won the Super Bowl. I mean,
yep.
You feel like you could jump over a car, probably have a hot girlfriend, you know, shotgun beers.
Sounds like an amazing life, I'm going to be honest with you. But the point
Except
on
you get your head turned into a canoe every day. Yeah.
Yeah. The point is people who play college football are assuming a high level of risk, right? For the physical danger of football itself.
Right, and that is their identity.
That's right.
So the idea that you would take that
away from them based on your fear for them is that there's a huge contradiction or hypocrisy there, because you're not concerned about CTE. You're not concerned about the body being physically beaten up every single week in order to play football. You're concerned about a virus which has like a 99.99% recovery rate for young, healthy people. It just doesn't make any sense at all from a purely logical perspective.
Yeah, but we don't live in a time of logic.
Unfortunately.
And, you know, it's interesting to me to watch the whole thing unfold, because players do feel that way, but you also have to know, like, people aren't stupid. I mean, This is bringing out more of the humanity of football, whereas, you know, video games and fantasy football took a lot of that away from us in the last decade, where we don't think of a lot of these guys as human. I mean, there's most NFL players that you recognize their name, you'd have a hard time recognizing their face.
Yeah.
Because they wear helmets. So if this does one thing to kind of humanize the player in people's eyes, that's not a bad thing. But at the same time, most all of these guys are completely and totally bought in to this as their lives, and they know the deal. And some of them do a great job taking advantage of it at the universities with what's offered now. Some of them don't. I think they should get more, but there's a stumbling block there. The one thing that really, just really quick, because I know you got to go, it really jumps out to me is there's always been a glaring issue, Clay, of how unjust college football is. Like 2 months into my career, I realized what was happening and who I was to them and what they were to me. It was glaring. And so I guess I just feel a little goofy that suddenly it's become a huge topic, and suddenly it's obvious to everybody, you know, how awkward it is to have these teams in colleges and universities. It's always been that way to me. So it's just, I guess, I feel a little bit underwhelmed by everybody suddenly having these jolts of awareness about the sport we've covered for a long time.
Outstanding stuff as always. He's Petros Papadakis, AM 570 LA Sports at The Old P on Twitter. Thank you, my man. We'll talk to you next week.
Congratulations.
Thank you.